everyone. This is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending this webinar. It's a difficult time for all of us. COVID-19 and the novel coronavirus pandemic has disrupted daily lives and has caused the world economies to freefall into massive downward spiral. That is why we are now bringing this informative webinar by our esteemed mentor on how to stay positive during this crisis. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to introduce our speaker. He helps business owners think clearly, prioritize and implement simple yet effective strategies to set and achieve their goals. He loves to find solutions to a variety of challenges, and that's his passion. He strongly believes that entrepreneurs deserve a stress-free and enjoyable life, and his simplified strategies combined with process-oriented approach ensure exactly the same. He is a certified NLP practitioner, and that helps him understand and change people's mindsets, beliefs, and blind spots, which often are reasons for these situations. Please welcome Mr. Milind. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much, Sonali. Hello, everyone. Welcome, everyone, to this webinar on staying positive in crisis. Let me give you some guidelines first. I shall start my presentation and I'm hiding my video, not because I'm wearing short pants, but basically because I want to save on some bandwidth, because these days internet is being used widely by all the people and there could be some issues with internet bandwidth. So you'll see presentation slides on your screen, and in case I'm not audible or if there is any disturbance, let me know through the chat box. You have the option of choosing chatbots to send the messages to attendees or only to the panelists. If you have any questions, type them in Q&A section, not in chat box, because I'll be specifically going to the Q&A section to answer all your questions. I shall come back to the answers in the end. And I have specifically kept some time for question and answers. So let's try out our chat. Type in the name of the city you are in currently and also the profession, your profession, so that I get some idea of the audience. So type in the chat box your city, comma, your profession. So this will help me understand the lag as well and to get introduced to you. Also have a pen and notebook ready to take some notes, which you can refer to later on. So start putting in chat box, where are you from and what's your profession? Okay, so I see people from New Delhi, Singapore, fantastic, Hyderabad, Pune, Indore. Many people, yeah, Vadodara, New Delhi again, Hyderabad. Oh, fantastic. Pune. Okay, so I seem to have a good mix of different businesses and different professions. Fantastic. So let's go ahead. My name is Milind Bibikar and I'm talking to you from Pune. Look, I'm not a motivational speaker. Let me clarify that upfront. And I'm not a life coach either. I'm a business coach working with business owners on strategies, building their businesses, making more money from there, and so on. But today, I have to speak about positivity, that is staying positive in crisis. And there is a reason for it. Even if I'm not a life coach, I felt it extremely important to talk about this subject. And as I said, there is a reason to it. The reason is my own experience. Let me tell you why I chose this particular subject. When we were hit by this COVID-19 crisis and it became a little serious by about 20th of March in Pune, I know in some other areas of our, other regions of the country, it hit earlier, but in Pune, specifically where I live, it became a little more serious by around 20th of March. And I sensed a kind of big health crisis and unfortunately, even bigger economic crisis. It was very disturbing for me to realize that the small businesses are going to be hit very badly. And at that point of time, I decided to offer some free consultation to those business owners who are going through the difficulties. They were confused. They were stressed, scared, and worried about a whole lot of things. Where will my revenue come from? How will I pay for my expenses, EMIs? How do I pay my salaries? How do I pay my rent? Will my customers pay me? So I thought this is the time SME business owner, that is small and medium enterprises, the business owners require handholding. They require guidance on how to survive and sail through these difficult times. I felt it is my moral and ethical and even professional responsibility to help as many business owners as I could. And this will be done absolutely free of cost, because desperate time needs desperate measures. Hence, I put up this post on FB and LinkedIn. And it read like this. I guess there is some lag in changing the slide. Yeah, okay, I think the slide should be visible now. So I put up this post saying that during this crisis, I'm putting aside 5 pro bono hours a week to coach 5 business owners who need help to survive and thrive. Have them message me directly. Hashtag pandemic. Now, this is the post I did. Now, I was expecting that a decent number of business owners would reach out. One, because they were in trouble, they are in trouble. Number two, I offered it for free. It was free, so there was nothing to lose. And third, they had time. They were not busy because in the lockdown, they were at home. So all the three reasons, they were in trouble, there was nothing to lose because it was free, and they had time as the lockdown started. But I was wrong. Only one person reached out. Only one business owner reached out. Can you believe that? So I had all the doubts whether people saw my post or not. Why wouldn't they avail such services? They are getting these services worth almost 60-75,000 rupees, which is a normal condition, normal circumstances fee, and that they are getting this absolutely free. Why aren't they interested? Why aren't they trying to minimize the damage that it is causing to their business? Then I thought maybe I posted that too soon. You know, because as Action Coach Community, which is a global community, and we have coaches all around the globe, in some part of the world, this crisis hit earlier, and the coach community there already were working on this. And the post that I did, I thought maybe I posted it too soon here. So people would not have gathered themselves and probably yet to figure out what is it going to be like. Probably they have not realized the impact on their business yet. And it reminded me of the principle of the point of power. Now, usually we teach this principle in a different context, but it holds so true in this situation as well. Listen, your approach to any situation is important. You will react or deal with it based on your attitude and understanding. Like it or not, this is what was happening. Business owners were in denial mode first. So what were they denying? They denied the fact that it would hamper their businesses so much. They denied and are still denying that this is a long 5-6 months impact period minimum. Some of them still feel that it is going to be over on 15th of April. Sorry, this is not going to happen. It is not even going to happen by month end. If you deny this fact that the businesses are at the risk of shutting down, you will never act on keeping them running. So if you don't accept that there is a threat, you're not going to do anything to mitigate it. What we as coaches did in the first week with all our coaching clients was to explain them the severity and impact of the situation and prepare them for the worst case scenario. that was done immediately and they triggered many action at once. After a while, when the lockdown happened and there was a flood of negative news, discouraging statistics and dreadful scenes from Italy, China, Iran and all, people started realizing the impact of it. But then they started giving the excuse that what can I do? Everything is shut down. Excuse that at their customer's end, no one is working. No one is going to take any buying decisions for now. Everyone is at home. So what's the use of taking any actions? And when the frustration increases further, then we start blaming. You know, blame China. So first one was the denial, that the bottommost part, where we were denying the impact itself, denying that it was happening to us. We always thought it is happening somewhere else in China. We denied the fact that it is coming so close to us, until even for me, I realized the grave situation when a COVID-19 positive patient was found about 2 kilometers from my house. That's when we start getting into reality. Till that time, we are actually denying. And when the frustration increases further, then we start blaming. So blame China for starting this. Blame government for not taking steps quickly enough. Blame Kanika Kapoor for spreading this disease. Blame finance minister for not taking enough steps to save these businesses. Oh my God, there are so many people and so many things to blame. And we lose so much energy in this blame game. Instead, if you could just rise above this point of power and accept the fact that what has happened, that cannot be changed. We take the responsibility of our own safety, of our own business in this given situation. If you really understand the situation, it's a force majeure situation or a natural calamity situation globally. You cannot change the event. This is a global event. You cannot change the event, but you can definitely change your response to this event. You will realize your ability to respond to this only when you take the responsibility to get over it. So when you are above the point of power, you take the ownership of yourself, your family, your team, and your business, because no one else owns it. You own it. Below the point of power, you are actually powerless and a victim. But when you take the ownership, accountability, and responsibility, you will rise above the point of power. You will be in control and you will be powerful and you will come out as a victor. Now, after a gap of 2 weeks, 1 week, I posted yet another offer with little different messaging. The first messaging was about offering coaching. The second message was about survival, because that's when people started thinking about it. So it was a different, little different messaging. Still, only 2 people reached out. It's a different thing that I started coaching them for free and they have already started getting traction in their business. But the point here is people were still not in a mindset to do something about it. And that made me think about overcoming this mindset issue first before offering them the business solutions. So I thought, let us first work on their mind, get them out of whatever they are, you know, keeping them in a shell, let them come out of it, and then I can probably start offering them some business solutions when they are in the right mindset. So you need to be in the right mindset. Just let me check. There is somebody has put a chat message. I will just go through it. Okay. So, hence I analyze this further. And that's the reason I came up with this topic of discussion, even if I am not a life coach. Staying positive in crisis, this title probably suits better for a motivational speaker or a life coach better, but I'm doing it right now for you because I know it has to be done. It has to be done. It is very important. This is the right time to do it. Now, the fact is, no one here knows what animal we are dealing with. No one had seen it before. No one had heard about it. We don't even know what it wants, how it affects us. How is it going to affect my business, my economy, that too globally? No one knows, and that's the fear of unknown. And when there is fear, we humans, or rather should I say Homo sapiens, we are actually genetically programmed to respond it in some typical ways. Let's see what our response is to fear, because we are not actually dealing with just the coronavirus. We are actually dealing with the fear because of coronavirus. These are two completely different things. We can probably fight corona in a much easier way, but fighting fear is taking a toll. Now, in any fear situation, if you see historically, there are basically four responses to fear. Typical four responses. Now, one of the responses to fear is to fight. So fight the fear. So what involves in fighting is attacking. So attacking what has caused the threat. So attacking, fighting with whatever you have in your hand, just fight it out. Attacking anyone, even the rescuer at times. So while attacking, usually the emotion that we carry is anger. Now in present age, we attack not by weapons, but by words, by our actions. So we tend to insult, blame, or mistreat people around. So outcome here of this particular action or response to fear is either insulting someone, or we blame somebody, or we mistreat others, and even to self. We usually use this option if we feel that the danger is smaller, the threat is smaller or less powerful than us. Another response is flight. So moving away from it. So our ancestors, if I go to Stone Age, the cavemen ran away from something dangerous, and that helped them survive. Whatever helps you survive over and over again, it gets programmed genetically and passed on to the next generation through genes. So we tend to choose this response, that is to hide from or move away from. And that's for survival. The action here is hiding. And the outcome is we deny things. We deny existence of things. For example, in our corporate world, we deny review meetings when we know that we will be questioned. We deny review meetings because we know that our existence is at risk if I am found not performing well. So the survival in corporate world, we deny things which will challenge our existence. We avoid actually talking about it. And we omit a lot of stuff. We omit a lot of data. We don't present the right data. And we avoid the points which will cause argument. So this is flight. You are moving away. You are running away from the fear, or you are running away from the problem. So these are two responses, fight or flight, most commonly known and talked about. There is another response to this fear, which is freeze. Or I would say this is a response to intense fear. If you see a bright, big, very big threat which has appeared all of a sudden right in front of your face, the first response is usually to freeze. In such cases, the decision making in your brain shifts to very primitive or limbic brain. Now, our ancestors, this is again part of programming, and it has come through genes. Our ancestors who froze in front of the threat, and the threat usually used to be predators, probably they survived because the predators chased and killed those who were moving and running. So freezing came to us as a genetic program already written. And this program gets triggered when we face big unknown threat all of a sudden. So imagine a cobra as soon as you wake up in the morning, right in front of you. That's the kind of threat I'm talking about. Now, today the environment has changed. We no longer live in Stone Age, but our programming works exactly in the same way for the threats, even in modern age. In modern age, the response is to comply or to shut down or justify what is happening. So do you see a relation of how people behaved in the first initial phase of this lockdown? They were all either in fight mode or flight mode or freeze mode. And that's, so what I concluded was that the business owners were either in these three modes, fight, flight, or freeze, and had no time to look at the guidance available from experts to sell through these difficult times. So they missed out on something very, very important. Now, the fourth response is facing the fear. Now, there is a difference between fighting a fear and facing a fear. Fighting is usually, it is in a spurt of the moment without thinking through much. Whereas while facing the fear, you are calm, you are composed, and you are exploring and evaluating options to mitigate the risk. You have accepted it as a risk, and you are now finding out, you are preparing for the worst, and you're constantly connected to the people around you. You're constantly connected with the right people and the right sources of information to get over this problem. In current situation, you are connected more than ever with your team, with your family, with your customers, with your vendors, and so on. This is the best response to fear, as you are doing something constructive to defend yourself, to survive, and then thrive. Now, it is proven beyond doubt that those who face fear and explore options and take actions, they survive and then subsequently thrive in their businesses. Now, three people who responded to me after the offer, they are availing my business coaching services, and they have already started getting business. They pivoted their business model and identified many, many ways to utilize this time in the best possible productive manner. So only those who took action could get the benefit of working on something really, really important, and this made a lot of difference to their business even in this situation. As they say, we generate fears while sitting and we overcome them by actions. Now, at this point, I want you to put your comments in the chat box of what was your number one takeaway or learning so far from this session. Also type in questions, in if any, in the question section. I shall go through the answers at appropriate time, but let me understand what you have taken from this session as of now. I'll just take a minute to go through the chat. Okay, so what I see in the chat is the previous answer to my previous question. So I see a lot of people from Nagpur, in different profession, wedding services, interior designers, contractors, head operations for a logistic company. Now I see the learnings that facing the situation, face fear, and it goes, we should face the situation and not choose the other three options, fight, flight, or freeze, and rise above the situation. Fantastic. Okay, so this was just to make sure that you are awake and responding. Right, so moving forward, Now, this is not just about fear. This is not just about fear. We all need to understand actually how our mind works so that we can keep ourselves in the right and the positive mindset. This is something you need to know. So for you, this is what you need to go within and handle. And for this, one needs to know how information, beliefs, values, behaviors, actions, they work in a combination. And once you understand the hardware and the programming part, that is the body and mind and the software for it, it is all up to you to which program you want to write. Remember, the way you write the program, you will get the output accordingly. Choice is all yours. You have the choice to write the program the way you want it to happen. Interesting, right? So I'll be explaining a very small bit of NLP. So when I say NLP, it is neuro-linguistic programming, not natural language processing. It is neuro-linguistic programming. So I'm explaining a very small portion of NLP so that you can understand how mind works. So anyone in the attendees who have learned NLP, type yes in the chat box and followed by what level you have learned. So when I say level, it means whether you have completed your foundation course or the practitioner course or master practitioner course. And if you are not acquainted with NLP, you can just type in no in chat box. So let me just understand whether anybody here is familiar with NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. Okay, so most of the no's I'm getting, so probably this is a new thing for you. And some people have heard about it, but not really learned NLP. I would suggest that, I know it is meant for everybody. It is not just meant for the coaches like us, but it is meant for everybody. So most of the answers, I think almost 99% answers are that we are not aware of the NLP. So I'm going to explain you how mind works. Would that be interesting? Now, NLP is an awesome field. I do not practice the NLP therapy work. So NLP can be used for psychological therapies. I don't use it for that. I don't practice that. But it is useful for everyone to learn. Because this is a, I would say this is a basic life skill. It works in every field. It works in business. It works in relations. It works in the matters of health, wealth, sports, career, not just the psychological issues. Now, why this works in every field is because everything is a result of how mind works. And NLP addresses that part, how mind works and how it can be programmed. So let me explain you this NLP communication model. Very interesting. It is not as easy as we feel. We take such things for granted, or we assume some things because we do not know how our mind works. Now, before we understand about something and we act, there is a whole lot of processing that happens in your mind, both conscious and unconscious minds. So there is a whole lot of processing that happens between the event and our response to it. Although it happens in a fraction of seconds, all this processing, so we really have a very, very high capacity processor. And this whole process happens in a fraction of seconds, but it still follows the process every time. This is really interesting. So we are actually like a computer running on a program. Now imagine there is an event. When I say event, it is something just happening, any incidents. How do you come to know about it? How do you come to know about any of the event which is beyond your body? So we have five senses. So we come to know about any event through our five senses. And this we have studied long back in schools. The senses are sight, that is seeing, hearing, touch, smell, and taste. out of which, of course, most of the information that normally comes is through sight, that is seeing and hearing. Almost, I would say 70-80% of the information comes from seeing and hearing. So eyes and ears, these are the two organs which get you the information about what is happening outside. Now there is something called as modalities, VAK modalities. So V stands for visual, A stands for auditory, and K stands for kinesthetic. So these senses that get you the information from the event to you, they get it in the form of seeing, hearing, touching, smelling, and tasting. Now, based on what is your preferred model or modality, you will get that information in a better way. So let's say if you are a visual person, you will look at the visual things first. If you are an auditory person, you will listen to the things. And if you are a kinesthetic person, you will feel the things. So a very small example to explain this, if you go and buy a shirt or a dress for yourself, a visual person will look at the visual of the shirt or the dress and make a choice based on that. An auditory person will probably listen to what the salesperson is saying about that fabric or about that shirt or dress. Whereas a kinesthetic person will be comfortable trying it out. So wearing it, trying it out, medicine. So this is the different ways in which people learn or get information from outside world. And there are preferred channels, visual, auditory, or kinesthetic. And this changes from person to person. Now, once you get information from all these senses, there are certain natural filters that this information goes through. Now, why these filters? The filters are there basically because the speed of getting the information, it is coming from your five senses. The speed of getting the information from outside world is very, very high as compared to how you can process it, the speed with which you can process this information. So processing speed limits the input of information. So some of the information is deleted. So we don't even register that information. Some information is distorted based on our understanding. And sometimes we generalize. So some things get unnoticed. That means the information is deleted. Some things we get the wrong information. That means it is distorted. And this is all happening in your mind. It is not happening from the external sources. This is where saying whatever information you have already got, out of it, something gets deleted, something gets distorted, and something gets generalized. So we generalize a lot of things. Just to give a very quick example, if you see a Chinese man next to you, right now you will be scared. Because we are generalizing that Chinese people have been affected with coronavirus. Now there could be an Indian guy, your neighbor could be infected with this, and you will still not be as scared as being next to a Chinese man. So this we are generalizing that all Chinese people are, affected because of this. So these are the filters which are naturally there. So the filters filter out some information, and while filtering out, they actually change the information itself, because it is coming in a different form to you now. And once it comes into your mind, into your brain, then there are a whole lot of things actually already going on in your brain. So in your unconscious, you have some mental programs which are already written. You have some values, you have some beliefs, and you will appreciate this, that every person will have different beliefs. Every person will have different values. Every person will have their own meta programs. And in addition to that, every person has different memories. There are different decisions that people take. The decisions are not the same for two people. So there are so many things that are going on in your mind, which will process the information, what you have got from the five senses through the filters. It processes this information and makes some meaning out of it. So once you make a meaning out of it, there is also more things involved. What state are you in? what state are you in? So it has again a lot of variables, your age, your place, where are you, what are you doing, what is your physiology, are you standing, are you sitting, are you running, what posture you are carrying currently, that's physiology, what expressions you are carrying currently. Also, your internal representation of the meaning of this information that has been processed. So all this put together, you will come out or you will make a meaning out of the information that you have received. And based on the meaning, then you will design your response to it. And that response is in the form of a behavior. Now, behavior means actions. It could be just, even the body movements is called behaviors. So there are certain instantaneous factors such as your state, your internal representation, your psychology, physiology. Based on this, you will act. Behavior means actions. Now, you can imagine why everyone will behave or respond differently to the same event or the same situation. What we call truth is different for everybody. If there are so many variables between the event and the response, that is event and the behavior, how can it be same? How can it be the same for all? You know, for example, if there is, depending on your VAK modalities, if you are getting different information of visuals, auditory, and kinesthetic, your input source itself is different. If your filters are different, what you are deleting, what you are distorting, and what you are generalizing, if the filters are different for different people, the sense that you are making out of this information is completely different. Everybody's values, beliefs, programs, memories, decisions, everything is different. So this whole information is getting processed differently for every person. And based on that information which is being processed, you are making the internal representation of this process. And again, based on your state, your physiology, you are going to act on it. You are going to behave as per the response that is generated by your subconscious mind, unconscious mind. Now, everybody has different things. Everybody has processed this information differently. Now, a very, very simple example that everybody knows, everybody sees this day in and day out. See what happens. So another thing that I will cover in this is that your internal representation or your beliefs or your values also change what you see, what you hear, and how you analyze it. It also affects or influences your filters. What to delete, what to distort, and what to generalize. Everything gets distorted. Everything gets changed based on your programming. And the programming basically comes from your values, beliefs, memories, and decisions, and the meta programs that are running in your head. So even your senses, that is your eyesight, your hearing, is controlled by your beliefs. This is how, just to give an example, everybody has gone through various debates between Modi bhakts and Modi haters. Now, Modi bhakt will only sense the information. They will only get the information which is positive, which is talking positive about Modi's actions. And Modi haters will exactly look at only the other counter arguments or the other issues with Modi's decisions. So that's how this deleting, distortion, generalization, this happens because of the values and the belief system being different for different people. Now, how this relates to the current situation? This is interesting. I explained all this thing, all this theory, basically to explain the next part, which is event is the same. The pandemic crisis, the event is the same. But what information is coming to you and how you are processing this information is making the entire difference. If you are in fear because of this, if you are blaming somebody, if you are frustrated, you might get into inaction. So if your belief is that everything is going to shut down and nothing is going to work out for my business, if this is the thinking, then your behavior is to not act, not do anything. And you will attract more of such information, which will keep you inactive. This strengthens your belief that we are heading for a doomsday. This is heading to the belief that we are going to hit a massive economy slowdown. And if you have this kind of belief, which is very, very strong, that anyway, the economy is not going to do well, then your actions will be according to your belief. So you will go in a shell, you will contract. You will not think about expanding. But what happens if the information itself, if you change the inputs? You know, there is a way you can change the inputs. That is the senses, information coming from senses, five senses. What if you can change your beliefs? What if you can change your programming? And even change your state, your physiology, your internal representation. Now, what will be the action? Now, let's say if you're getting positive news, and because you have worked on your beliefs and your values, you're getting the information and you're processing it in a completely different way. You're using the right state of mind, right physiology to behave. Your actions could be entirely different. So do you understand now what I meant by when I said you can choose your program? So this is just like your computer hardware and software. Mind will execute the program that you have written. You can write a program to perish or you can write a program to prosper. Choice is all yours. Now there is long training, 7-day, 10-day trainings to learn about this. I've just explained one small part in last 10, 15 minutes about NLP. But once you understand this, you will know that it is important to work on the mind or the mindset. And that is entirely in our control. Working on our mind, working on our mindset is entirely in our control. No one can take control, this control from you unless you give it to someone. Now, once how it is clear, why this is to be done and how it is to be done. If this is clear, then what to do is very simple. Now let's look at very, very simple actions that you can take to work on your mind. So all this explanation that I, gave about programming of mind is basically to make you comfortable in the fact that you can choose your program. Now, if that is done, let's move on to the next part, which is what can we do? So in short, if I had to summarize, your beliefs will determine your behavior, that is actions, and your actions will determine the experience that you get. The experience that you get strengthens or weakens your beliefs. It will basically strengthen the belief, the same belief that you are carrying, and then that belief will further drive your behavior. So this is a vicious circle, I would say. If you are in this negative circle, it's a vicious circle. If it is a positive belief, positive behavior, that then it's a good thing to be in. But mostly in this current situation, it could be a negative circle and we need to break this. So to break this, we need to work on the mind. And when we are working on mind, there are three things that we need to keep in mind: guard, feed, and exercise. So what part is very easy? I'm going to run through it. Guard is stop the unwanted. Stop the unwanted things coming to your mind. Feed your mind with what is required, what is healthy for your mind. And exercise on your mind to remain healthy. So I'll quickly go through what can you do in guard? What can you do in feeding? And what can you do in exercising? So in guarding, first of all, it's the awareness. To be aware of what's going on in your mind, to be aware of the emotions that you're carrying currently. And once you're aware of this feelings, the emotions, you now look at what you need to stop doing. Now, what you need to stop doing is very, very clear. The news that you are getting, mostly they are all negative news. The media that is covering this particular problem, whether it is health issue or financial issue, the way it is being projected, mostly it is all negative. You must be getting lots and lots of messages on WhatsApp University, which tells you how bad is the situation. If you see or if you watch the news channel debates, I'm sure your blood must be boiling. You must be getting really, really, disturbed with the kind of allegations and the debates that happen on news channels. Resist your temptation to look at your worldometer statistics on coronavirus, because what you see there is only the increasing trend in terms of number of positive cases and deaths. Stop looking at the arguments between Modi bucks and Modi haters. That's of no use. All this thing is junk. All these negative inputs that coming to you are junk. Just guard your mind from these inputs. So you need to really work like a guard and allow only the right things to pass and stop all these negative things outside. You don't just accept it. It's absolutely in your control. You can stop watching news and paying heed to all these negative news. And the next thing that you can do is feeding your mind with positive things. So there are so many things that you can do to positively feed your mind. The best thing to do is to educate yourself. Get indulged into reading some good books. There are so many learning platforms like Udemy, LinkedIn Learning, and there are so many YouTube's videos that you can see. You can attend webinars on different subjects. This is the best time to learn. You are at home, you have time. So use this time to feed your mind with the positive things. Education is the most important thing in this. Do some positive affirmations. So that's like programming your mind. So good inputs to your mind will always change your beliefs for the good. Look at the positive news. In fact, what we have started is a discussion room or as a group where we share only the positive news. We don't look at the negative things. And most importantly, have some fun activity, which is a mind activity, and you also enjoy doing it. So this is how you can feed your mind with positive things. The next thing is to exercise. So just like your body needs you to work out, your mind also needs to work out. And the best workout for your mind is meditation. So I know that not everybody is good at meditation. Not everybody is expert at meditation. I am not. But there are so many avenues where you can learn. There are so many sources where you can learn guided meditation techniques. There are different frequency musics available. If you know and if you believe in existence of chakras in your body, there are different high frequency music or meditation musics available to balance out those chakras and give you those soothing relief and positive energy to go through. There is something called as IVVM. IVVM stands for idealize, visualize, verbalize, and materialize or manifest. Idealize, visualize, verbalize, and materialize. So idealize what you want to be. Visualize run a mental movie, what state you want to be in, what kind of working environment you want to be in, what kind of holiday destination you want to go to. So you can visualize that, you can idealize that. Start verbalizing it, start talking about it. Say that I'm doing this, say that I'm reaching there. And materializing is taking action on it. Start actions so that they materialize finally. So IVVM statements is something like there are 8-10 things that you want to do, you want to achieve. Keep telling this yourself like affirmations every day in the morning and the evening. I am statements is again an extension of IVVM, that is what you want to be. I am confident, I am healthy, I am wealthy. These are the things, these are the affirmations and that you can keep doing it. This is what is the feed for your mind. Maintain and improve your routine. That's another point. Very important, because if you fall off the routine, then you fall off the habits. If you really have good habits, maintain them, continue that. If you're getting up early, keep getting up early. And you need this exercise more often than ever in this situation. So to summarize, you just need to guard, feed, and exercise your mind. Now, here is an interesting point about why we need to work so much on our mind. So what happens is you face with different emotions, joy, happiness, sadness, anger, jealousy, pride, satisfaction. There are so many emotions that keeps popping up in your head. What happens is for positive emotion, just for the sake of representation, above the x-axis, you have positive emotions. Below the x-axis, you have negative emotions. So when it comes to positive emotions like joy, like happiness, the curve goes like this. From point zero, it suddenly spurts up. You are really happy at that peak point and you come back to normal quite quickly. So what I mean to say is the positive emotions last very short life. They have a very short life. Whereas if you are sad, if you are angry, if you are jealous, which is, let's say, a negative emotion, it lasts for a very, very, very long time. So if you have a hurt feeling, somebody has hurt you, this feeling will remain with you for a very, very long time. And when I say very long time, if you just have to make a comparison between this positive emotion of joy and happiness with an emotion of sadness, it is almost 200 times more in case of negative emotions. So negative comes actually, you know, it is natural thing to feel these negative emotions. But to remain positive, you really have to work hard. Now, irony is everything that is negative usually comes very easily. Heard about smoking habits, drinking habits, drugs. This come to people very easily without any effort. You don't have to make any effort to get into these kind of habits. Bad smell, foul smell, dead rat. You can smell from few hundred yards. But when it comes to positive things, you need huge efforts to be consistent with that. So like I said, smoking, drinking, drugs can come very easily, but exactly opposite to that, maintaining a very good diet schedule, exercise schedule, this requires a lot of effort. So to remain positive, you need to put in efforts. And that's why I insisted so much on working on your mind continuously to remain in this positive state. Because it is going to take a lot of efforts to remain positive rather than getting into negative. Moving forward, I think for the body, it is again the same, exactly the same thing as in mind. That is guard, feed, and exercise. So guard what is, stop what is unwanted, allow what is good, what is required, and exercise. So in guarding, you need to protect yourself from and your family against this coronavirus by all the actions that everybody is talking about, washing your hands, not going out, covering with masks, everything. This is, everybody is talking about it. You are aware of it. What you consume, what you eat, your diet is absolutely important at this point of situation. Be aware of what you're eating. Stop binge eating. Stop eating just because you are getting bored. Stop eating, having that extra cup of teas. Consult a nutritionist. A nutritionist can really guide you of what you should be eating at this point of time. Don't buy junk food at all in the first place. Nowadays, you're going out to buy groceries very rarely. You are not going every day. So stop the temptation of buying something which is junk. And again, maintain your routine. Feed your body with balanced diet. Plan your groceries accordingly. Consult a nutritionist who can give you good guidance of what you really want to eat or what you should be eating, and keep drinking water. And the last part is exercise. So get into this exercise mode. Set some smart goals for your health. Maybe reduction of some weight, few inches, or gaining some weight if you want. Exercise even if you haven't been exercising earlier. You can do a lot of things at home. There are floor exercises. There are yoga that you can do. There is yoga that you can do. And again, there are so many places where you can learn how to do that if you have not been doing it. And maintain your routine. So you definitely are saving a lot of time probably that you spend in travel. Use that time for the right things and do some funny things like dance if you like. So get into some kind of activity which is a fun for you. So for both mind and body, you need to guard, you need to feed with the right things, guard against the unwanted things, and exercise it, whether it is mind or your body. Again, I will repeat the program that you use will decide the future. You can program your mind. Choice is yours. What do you want to feed that with? Now, here is an offer. If any one of you is a business owner, this offer still holds good, that I'm going to have a free call with you for 30 minutes. If you want to get some actions, concrete actions to come out of this situation, survive this situation, and then prepare for thriving in this situation after the lockdown is lifted. So there are so many things that we can do, and our clients are already doing it. So I'm open to have a free 30 minute call with you to understand your business and then give you some guidelines. So write to me on the email ID that I have written on the screen, milindbibikar@actioncoach.com. And my number is 9823082268. I'll be showing this number in the last slide as well. So now it's time to get into action, because I'll repeat what I said. You generate fears while you sit, and you overcome them with your actions. So it's time to get into action, do some productive stuff. Thank you very much. It's almost the time. I'll now go through the questions and answer them one by one. So start. Do me a favor. Do two things. One is write down in your chat box what was your number one learning. What is your takeaway from today's session? How did you like it? And if you have any question, put it into question and answer section. Don't put it in chat. So I'll go to the question and answer section and try and answer a few of them. Okay, so one question is, when we take the accountability, how you can help businesses? So accountability is about being accountable to somebody. So for example, when if you are working for a company and you are accountable for your actions to your boss or to your management, we have seen that the performance goes up. Unfortunately for business owners, there is very less accountability, because nobody is asking them, what are you doing as a business owner? So normally what happens is business owner end up doing the stuff which is required for survival. For example, a business is accountable to generate cash, to pay the installment to the bank, to pay interest to the bank. They are accountable to pay the salaries to their employees. They are accountable to pay their vendors. So they end up normally earning enough only to pay these expenses. But nobody holds them accountable to generate profit for themselves. It is a choice. Now, if they are not accountable, usually that is the area that gets hit and they don't generate enough profits. So by being accountable, that means that we are keeping account of our actions and being accountable to our goals. If you do that, then it definitely helps each and every business. Second question that I'm getting is, I'm calm, want to face the situation, but no leads. How to go ahead? Now, this is a specific personalized question. We can get on a call for 30 minutes and see what best can be done in this situation, the situation that you are in. I may not have solution for every problem. For example, if travel industry, it is going to get hit. There is nothing much that can be done for a few months. But there are many other businesses that we have been working with. They have pivoted their business models and started doing something different. They have started getting more aggressive in their sales and marketing, and they are getting traction out of it. So let me talk to you once, one-on-one, Mr. Sanjay Malpani. We'll get in touch and set up a call to discuss your particular business in detail. How to make a strategy in unethical market? How to compete in extra credit-oriented market? So here is a classic example of what you believe. So what I understand when you ask this question, how to make strategy an unethical market, you are believing that the market is unethical. Now this belief is going to hamper your actions. This belief will drive your actions. There are ethical people in the market. That's the belief that you want to have. I work with only ethical businesses. That is the belief that you want to have. My customers pay the price that I demand. This is the belief that you want to have. Of course, there's a lot of work that will go in. A lot of actions also need to happen simultaneously. It's just not thinking about it, but you also need to have some strategies in place, but first the mindset and then the strategies. Another question, hi, any book that you can recommend on NLP? I'll get back to you on this about the book, but see, NLP is a subject that needs to be taught. It is very, very difficult, and that's my own experience, that it is very difficult to learn NLP by reading book. You can always watch some videos that will give you a better understanding of NLP, and there are foundation courses, there are practitioner courses that happen in almost all the cities, Pune, Mumbai, Delhi. There are a lot of people, a lot of trainers in NLP, and it doesn't cost much. So it would be better if you get in touch with some NLP trainer, NLP practitioner, master practitioner to get trained on this particular topic. Any more questions? How will you guide or guide for the startup company? I will have to talk to you to answer that question, because it's not one formula that fits everybody. So startup company, we can definitely work on creating a roadmap for you, creating a vision for you, and give you some set of concrete actions that we know work in this market. Okay, other questions are more about their personal businesses. So I would request that I have given you the contact number, the email ID. You can write to me, and I promise to get back to you one-on-one to set up a 30-minute call. Even if it takes 60 minutes, not a problem. I have allocated that time for discussing all the business-related solutions. So you can definitely get in touch with me on the email ID and phone numbers that I have given. So I think that's, I have answered all the questions, most of the questions, I think, that were there in the chat box. So over to you, Sonali, to conclude, please. Thank you very much for attending this session, to everybody. I appreciate a lot.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful session. It was absolutely great having you here, and thank you for sharing your insights with us. And to all our attendees, thank you so much for your time. We hope you were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And yes, please contact Mr. Milind if you have any questions at all, and if you would like to have a one-on-one chat with him. So please get in touch with him or me. I can share the message with him as well. And yes, we'll see you next time with our next webinar. It's on 13th of April. So if you need any further details about that as well, please get in touch with me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. See you, and all the best. Take care. Stay safe. Thank you.